We are in Exodus chapter 14 still. We read through most of it, but I want to keep going through there. There's a couple more things I wanted to share with you. Actually, turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, if you would. So you got your finger in Exodus 14. That's good. That way you can flip back over really fast. Exodus chapter 10, starting in verse 1. Let's all stand and read it together. Oh, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Whatever, you know what I'm talking about. I don't have an excuse, I don't know. I drank some cough medicine, that's what happened. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1, it says, moreover, oh my goodness. Maybe we're going to have a day here. We're going to have a good time. Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things became our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted, and do not become idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Now, nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Nor complain as some of them also complained and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you, except such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Let's stop right there. Let's pray. And Father, we come before you, and Lord, we're just so thankful for how good you are to us. And Lord, for the way that you lead us in our walks with you. God, we thank you for examples in Scripture, the good ones as well as the bad ones. Excuse me, the bad ones as well as the good ones. And Father, as we're going through and looking at some of these things in the book of Exodus, we just pray that you'd be glorified and that our faith would be strengthened, and that we'd follow you with a full heart. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You have a seat. In verse 11 there, it says, now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the ages have come. And so when you're going through Exodus and Numbers, Book of Deuteronomy, you can know that one of the things that God was doing with those people when he was leading them through the wilderness and they were going through some of the trials that they were going through, was that God was going to use it as a teaching example for us upon whom the ends of the ages have come. In other words, I need to be paying attention to what happened with these guys. You know, there are different ways of learning lessons, and one of the ways of learning lessons is what the Bible calls gnosko. It's knowledge that is intimate in the sense of I've gone through it. That's a great way to learn a lesson, gnosko. You know what a better way to learn a lesson is? Look at somebody else's gnosko and glean some wisdom from it. And as you go through the book of Exodus and actually the next couple of chapters that we're going to be dealing with, you're going to see God doing some awesome things in the lives of these people, and he blesses them, and it's a really neat thing. But then what happens when you get on into the book of Numbers is they start taking the blessing for granted, and they start complaining. They just become a bunch of gripers. And as it says in 1 Corinthians 10, with most of them, God was not well pleased, and their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. And you don't want that to be happening to you on any kind of level. You know, whether you're talking about a spiritual level where God takes you and puts you, you know, puts you on the shelf some at some point because you're just no longer useful, or in other ways, obviously. We want to be people who follow Jesus and follow him faithfully and without the griping and moaning that the world is so well known for. One of the things that I gleaned from the book of Exodus and also from the book of Numbers is how to discipline my kids. There are two things that you see God disciplining his people for in the wilderness, and one of them is outright rebellion, when they just did exactly the opposite of what God told them to. So there's an example on the Sabbath day. God has granted the people the Sabbath day, given it to them, told them what the rules were for the Sabbath. Do not collect any, you know, do not work on the Sabbath. Don't go out and do anything. Just hang out, you know, and rest on the Sabbath day. Next Sabbath day, guess what one dude was doing? He's out working, picking up sticks. And what happened was he was put to death for the whole thing. Outright rebellion. And so you know the rules, you don't want to do the rules, you want to do the exact opposite of the rules, that's rebellion, okay? And then the other issue was bad attitudes, wrong attitudes, the two R's. I think I mentioned these a couple of weeks ago. Ooh, cough medicine is not good for Steve in the morning. I don't know. It's either that or it was the medicine I took last night. I'm not sick. I'm just getting over a cough. In any case, wrong attitudes and rebellion. I know that one is a W and the other is an R, but I like to call it the two R's. And what you see with the people of Israel in the wilderness is that many times they had wrong attitudes. They murmured and they complained, and they despised the provision of God, and they looked back on their captivity, their slavery, and they thought it was better than what God was giving them. And God disciplined them for that. And so when I looked at disciplining my kids, those are the two things that I looked for. If my kids were in outright rebellion, I always tried to make sure that the boundaries were clear, and we would do that. And if the boundaries were clear and they knew what was going on, then they got disciplined for that, which in my house was a whooping, a spanking. And actually, I always did it with my hand. Bobby used various implements. I'm a big guy. I want to know what I'm doing when my hand is coming up against their little bottoms. In any case, they always knew that. And so the two things that I would be watching out for was you're just flat out disobeying me. And the other thing is I don't like bad attitudes. Bad attitudes reek. And so we would give them warnings and go get a, you know, Bobby did this famously. She'd go, you need to go do what I said, and you need to go do it with a happy heart. And that's the first thing that she would say. And then she'd say, put a smile on your face. And then the kids would do this. She'd go, no, I want a better smile than that. And they'd get a big smile. Yes, Mommy. And, you know, off they'd go. We'd still do that. They're teenagers. Actually, my daughter's 21 now, and we still do that with them. Get a smile on your face right now. No, we don't. I'm just joking. In any case, good stuff to be paying attention to as we're going through, and as far as application for our lives, our admonition, it's the idea of our teaching. And so God wants to teach us things through this. And we've been going through, actually we started last week with a crossing of the Red Sea. And we got through part of it. There were a couple other things that I wanted to do with this, and all in the context of God leading you. You know, last week we talked about the fact that God is the one who wants to bless us, and we don't need to go around blessing him. Out of Psalm 50, God, the people of Israel thought that they were feeding God when they made sacrifices. And God said, if I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. I don't need your help here. And what you need to do is you need to call upon me in the day of trouble, and I'll deliver you, and you'll glorify me. And the context there, again, is all about God's leading and God's work in a person's life. And the whole story of the crossing of the Red Sea is a great one, because basically what God does with these people is he gets them out of Dodge. They're going out of Egypt, and he begins leading them. And again, if you look over in chapter 13, in verse 21 and 22... it says, the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so as to go by day and night. He did not take away the pillar of cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night from before the people. And so God is literally leading these guys. And when he leads them out of Ramses, the area that they had been enslaved in and the area that they had been working in, I'm looking for something here. Yeah, there you are. Okay, the area that they had been working in, what he does is he leads them up to the Red Sea, and he literally blocks them in. He brings them to a point where they can't get away. And at the beginning of chapter 14, we read this last week, so I'm not going to go over it again, but at the beginning of chapter 14, what happens with Pharaoh is he's sitting there looking at the Israelis because they start going down south, and then they turn around and come back north, and what he thinks is that they're lost in the wilderness, that they don't know what they're doing. They don't know how to get out of Egypt, basically. And I talked last week about the fortifications that were up against the eastern border of Egypt. And so at that point, he becomes encouraged to go back to his hard-heartedness. He'd let the people go, but now he's hard-hearted again. And that was a work of God in Pharaoh's heart. So he's got spies looking for these guys. These guys are wandering in the wilderness. He figures, well, maybe, I don't know what the guy figures, because he's just had 10 plagues come down on him, and it finally forced him to let these guys go. And they get in the wilderness, and the least indication that it's not going well for the Israelis, he uses it as an excuse to come down on them again and try to destroy them. And so he brings up all his chariots and his armies, and he goes down after the Israelis, and he backs them up against the Red Sea. And then God begins fighting for them. It says in verse 10 of chapter 14, it says, when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you dealt so with us to bring us up out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness? And they've complained a couple of other times before this point, but this is the first instance of them complaining after they come out of the land of Egypt. And what God does is he graciously helps them. He overlooks the complaint because they're new. They don't know what they're doing yet. And he overlooks the complaint, and what he does is delivers them. In verse 13, and Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward, but lift up your rod, stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I indeed will harden the hearts of the Egyptians. They shall follow them, so I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, his chariots, and his horsemen. Then the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gained honor for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his horsemen. You know, when you look at the whole issue of God's deliverance in this passage, and again, I'm putting it in the context of our admonition. Like I was talking about last week, there are times when God will lead you up to a point. You think that God's leading you. This is what happens with people. They think that God's leading them. And they get up to a hard point, and when stuff starts getting hard for them, all of a sudden they're not sure anymore. And they start complaining, and they go, it was better when I was back here. What's going on in this situation? And one of the things that needs to be happening in a Christian's life is you need to be interested enough in God's leading to be seeking him so that you know that you're in the spot where you're supposed to be when you are led into a hard spot. And this is what I mean by that. You know, I used to, when I was a young Christian, having God lead me became a really big issue because I read my Old Testament. And so I'd go through and I'd read about David, and David would do things like he'd go seek the Lord, and God would tell him what battle plan to do, where to go, whether or not somebody was going to betray him. All this stuff was going on in David's life, and you could see that God was just flat out speaking to the guy. Well, one of the things that I know from the New Testament is that the guys in the Old Testament don't have the access to God that I have. Jesus was talking about John the Baptist, and he said he's the greatest of the Old Testament prophets, but greater is the least of those who are in the kingdom. You know why? Because before Jesus died on the cross, rose from the dead, and gave the Holy Spirit to his people, you don't have a situation in the Old Testament where God dwelt inside these people. Where God dwelt when he was manifesting himself was in the tabernacle, or he dwelt in the temple. When you get to the New Testament, who is the tabernacle? Who is the temple? We are. And so now I have God living inside me. And so I'm just stupid enough to take the Bible seriously. And so my thinking on that was, you got these guys in the Old Testament who are obviously being led by God, and God is speaking specifically and directly to them, and they didn't have the Holy Spirit living inside them. They weren't the temple of God. And God can do that with them in the Old Testament. And here I am in New Testament times, and I have God dwelling inside me, and all of a sudden everything's going to get vague for me while it's specific for them. What is that? And I didn't like it. And so what I did was I started praying, and I started asking God to speak to my heart like he spoke to David, like he spoke to Elijah. There was this one point where Elisha has a situation come up, and he was told about it by his servant, and he's just blown away by the fact that he didn't know about it. He was blown away by the fact that God hadn't spoken that to him. And so his attitude was that God would speak to him and he would know things before they came to pass. And when it didn't happen with him, he was surprised about that whole thing. And I'm not saying that I'm on the level of an Elisha, but I would like to be somebody who is surprised when God doesn't let me know about things before they take place, like big events in my life before they take place. And one of the things that, this is just some experience from being a Christian for a long time and making mistakes and stuff. One of the things that I've noticed is when I've gotten myself in bad situations, I go back in my head and I start thinking about, you know, because I'll be in the middle of a bad situation, and I'll kind of be like Elisha was and go, what is up with this? Why didn't God tell me? Why didn't God show me? You know, I'm going the wrong direction. I want God's will, so what's going on here? And so what I would do is I'd go back in my head and see if there were markers, see if there were situations that came up that where God was trying to get my attention and I just wasn't paying attention. And so I've had some situations over the years with ministry and stuff where I've put guys in ministry and then, you know, they've gone off the deep end. I'm talking about people in other states, but they've gone off the deep end and stuff. And then I would look at that and I go, well, what was that about? You know, what's going on there? And then I go back and look at the relationship that I had with them, and almost every single time, actually every single time that I can think of, every single time there was a big situation that took place between me and that person that should have been a red flag for me. And I kind of just went, well, he's having a bad day. And I don't want to take that away. I don't want to be cynical towards people. But I can see that there were times where God would point things out to me, and there'd be kind of this like little alarm going off in my head. And I'm like, no. You know, I'm just moving on with my life. And then later on, there's an eruption that comes from that, and it was because I wasn't paying attention. And there would be times, again, where I would be reading through my Bible, and it would be applying to situations, and I was just like, oh, no. And it's kind of because I didn't want it to happen. I didn't want it to be that way. I didn't want it to be like that. And so I would just, you know, ignore it and stuff and move on. And I guess what I'm saying to you is pay attention. When I talk with people and they have something awful that takes place in their life, and they're wondering, what was God doing? What was he doing while this was coming on me? Was he doing anything? And what I do with people like that is I go, I don't know. Was he doing anything? Was he speaking to you about this? Did you have any checks in your spirit before these things happened? Was there anything going on where God was trying to lead you in a different direction? And most often, the answer is yes. And again, they just weren't paying attention to it. And my point here is that God leads people. He leads his people. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. And you heard God's voice on the day that you got saved. It's why you got saved. God, the Bible says that nobody comes to Christ unless the Father draws him. And so God's at work drawing people to a relationship with Jesus. And the day that you gave your life to Christ is because God was doing a work in your heart and he was speaking to you and saying, this is the way, walk in it. Go that direction. And you responded to him at that point. And then from that point on, God wants to continually lead you. And so it's important to be paying attention to what God's saying to your heart in situations. And it's important to be in the Word of God so that it can speak to you in those situations. So basically, in my evolution as a Christian, what started happening was I decided I'm tired of getting blindsided. I don't want to get blindsided by stuff anymore. I want to know what's up when I get to these positions where it looks like I've got this fork in the road and I'm having real problems as to whether or not I should be doing one thing or the other. I want direction is basically what I was doing in those situations. And if I get direction, I want to know that this is something that God has spoken to me. And so you've heard me talk about this before when we talk about the leading of God and getting specific direction from God. I like verses. I want verses. So God can speak to my heart, and he does that all the time. But again, when I'm coming up against a problem later on, a lot of times the thing that God spoke in my heart kind of fades away, and I start forgetting what, you know, the feeling that was taking place and the reality of it when he spoke it to me, because my circumstances are starting to drown those things out. Let me give you some examples. So when I'm first married, one of the things that was happening was I was praying about where God wanted me to go as far as ministry went. And I spent a long time doing that. And finally, I'm driving down the freeway in Southern California, and God speaks to me and tells me to look up towards the mountains. There are these mountains in Southern California, the San Bernardino Mountains. He says, I just turned towards the mountains. And as soon as I did that, God spoke to my heart, and he said, that's where I want you to be. Okay, well, I had been involved in the startup of a church, Calvary Chapel of Big Bear, the year before. And so I'd been back and forth as to whether or not God wanted me to go there. And I'm not going to give you the whole all the details on that, but I didn't want to go. And so it was something that God had to overcome an attitude with me. And so I look up in the mountains. God says, that's where I want you to be. I go home, and I tell my wife, and she's like, yeah, no. This is what I live with. And so what she does is she tries to rent a house in Riverside across the street from her sister because she wanted to be by her sister. And there was all these things that she tried to do. And every time, and I just backed off and let her do it. Go for it. God has spoken to me. Nothing you do is ever going to come to pass. And so I didn't say that to her, but that was in my head. And so she did all kinds of stuff to try to get over to Riverside, and it just didn't happen. It wasn't going to take place. And so finally God spoke to her and said, you know what he said to her? Do what your husband says. I was really happy about that too, but I kept my mouth shut. And you'll notice she's not in the room today. Okay, so second service is going to be significantly different when I get to this story. But I know that you're gossips and slanderers, and that you're going to go and tell her. Actually, it wouldn't be slander because it would be the truth. So I don't care. In any case, I get up to Big Bear, and it was good at first, and then for, you know, about the first year, it was good, and for the last 6 years, it was a real trial. And what happened with that, and I didn't tell you some of the other stuff, was as soon as God spoke to me about moving up, you know, just by me looking up at the mountains, what I did was I went to my Bible and I said, God, I know that's you. I'm pretty sure it's you. Will you give me something in the Word that I can hang on to? And so he gave me a number of verses in the Bible. And I can't remember them off the top of my head, but verse after verse, it just spoke about, yes, this is me. This is the way that I'm leading you. This is what I want you to do, and that kind of stuff. And so I wrote them down. And so then I get up in Big Bear and I start having some trials. And I never even thought about the idea that I wasn't supposed to be there. Never even, not even a little bit. And what I did was I just endured through the trials, and then God finally moved me on. And so it was a cool thing. And so I may be going through trials, I may be going through hard times, but I have no question as to whether or not God had led me there. And it was the same thing coming up here. We had a prayer meeting where for a year, me and some people that came up, including Mitch, you know Mitch, and also Ruby, who came up to the Tri-Cities, and we had a prayer meeting for a year, and it was the direction that God gave me was specific, and it was really intense. And so I can't remember if I've told this for a while, but one of the things that just cracked me up was that God gave me a verse in the book of Deuteronomy about cities of refuge, and it talks about three cities on a river, right? And I'm like, what? You know, and it was just one of those things. I'm reading through, and I'm praying, and I'm asking God to give me some direction, and this whole thing with three cities on a river comes up, and I'm just like, huh? And so, you know, I just kind of write it down, and I'm like, whatever. You know? And so when this was kind of early on, a couple months later, when we've gotten some more direction, thought we were supposed to go to Washington, I called up and talked to the pastor of Calvary over in Seattle and said, hey, you got any places that, you know, need a fellowship and that kind of thing? Just kind of, you know, checking things out. And he said, no, Steve, I don't really know any. Tell you what, call Ken Ortiz over at Calvary in Spokane, see what he says. And so I go, okay. So I call him up, and he goes, yeah, there's, you know, we got a church up here and stuff like that. Have you considered the Tri-Cities? And I go, what's that? And he goes, it's these three cities on the Columbia River. And I'm like, really? You know, I didn't tell him because he would have, you know, he might have thought I was a Looney Tune. You know, I escaped from Kellogg's, one of the Fruit Loops and stuff. But, you know, it's like, that kind of stuff goes on with me all the time. And so I've got a page of typed out verses. Actually, it's sitting on my desk right now. Typed out verses that God gave us with all kinds of verses written on the side in Marcy Dunphy's hand. All around this whole thing. All passages that God spoke to me and to other people about moving up here to the Tri-Cities. And so that all happened back in 1989. We moved up here in 1990, and I have never once, no matter what kind of trials I'm going through, questioned whether or not God led me here. In fact, if I question it, it would be really stupid for me to question that because of all the times that God spoke to me about that. So when I'm going through trials or when things are hard or when I don't know what's going on, I can go back to the verses that God's given me and get some comfort out of that, and you know, it just brings it all back to me in the sense of letting me know that, yeah, this is what God had spoken to me, and yeah, I've been led by the Lord, and here I am. And I don't want to make that stuff up. I'm really careful about my flesh. I know that I can speak the voice of God to me. Yes, my son, this is the way. Go in it. Buy that new fill in the blank, because I have blessed you. You know, and that kind of thing. So I can imitate the voice of God, and I want to be real careful about that. Same thing in other situations. And this one, I didn't get a verse about this, but it was something that God, again, spoke to me when I was a brand new, or not a brand new Christian, but brand new married. And so the first year I was married, I don't think she'll care. Okay. going out on a limb here. The first year I was married, my wife got pregnant. She had a miscarriage. And so after she had the miscarriage, that's just, one of those things. And it was a bummer, but after she had the miscarriage, I started praying about my kids. And God told me that I was going to have two children, and that the first one was going to be a girl, and this is the only thing that he told me about names. My first child was going to be a girl, and I was to name her Bethany. So that's my first kid. He didn't tell me what to name the second kid, but he told me that he was going to be a boy, okay? And so that's when I was probably 23 at that point, maybe 22 still at that point. And so I know two things. I'm going to have two children, and the first one is going to be a girl. The second one's going to be a boy, obviously. And then I'm to name the first child Bethany. That's when I'm 22. We didn't get Bethany until I was 35. So for all that time, we're going through stuff, and Bobby can't get pregnant, and we did a bunch of testing and all that kind of stuff. And when it got to the point where they were going to have to do surgeries on her and stuff like that, I just went, yeah, no, we're not going to do that. I'm not going to, and I don't care if other people do that. I just didn't want to, and I was sure that God had told me what he had told me. And so I could just rest in that. And so lo and behold, my 35th year comes along, and there we get Bethany. In my 39th year, that's when we got Nathan. And so two children, first one was a girl, and that's why she's named Bethany. And there was no question about whether or not she was going to be named Bethany. And here's another thing that happened. Before I had my children, before we got Bethany, I had been talking to my little sister about this whole story and about what I was going to name my kid. So the year before my daughter was born, guess what my sister named my niece? Bethany. She stole my name. I haven't spoken to her since. No, I've spoken to her. And even though she named her kid Bethany, that's her deal. She can do that. That's fine. And I wasn't all bent about the whole thing. But even though she named her kid Bethany, it's not changing the fact that I'm naming my first child Bethany, because God told me when I was 22 that that's what her name's going to be. And so, again, God was speaking to me about my life long before these things ever happened. You know why he told me when I was 22? Is because he knew I had 13 years of waiting that was coming. And throughout those 13 years, even though Bobby sometimes would get depressed and that kind of thing, and then I'd just say, I'd tell her again what God had told me. And so it wasn't that overwhelming depression where, she would just didn't want to live because her womb was barren and, or whatever. She just never fell into that whole thing. And frankly, neither did I. And again, the reason was because I had a word from God where he spoke to me, and I knew my future. And so here I am, and, you have Bethany. She keeps trying to change her name. She goes, Beth, all the time. And I tell her, your name is Bethany. Heaven has spoken. And again, the reason I'm telling you that is because when I get backed up against the Red Sea, I'm not going to worry about how God's going to get me out of it. I don't have to worry about it because God has spoken to me. He's led me. I know that this is where I'm supposed to be. These are newbies. They had been led up to the Red Sea by the pillar of fire by night, pillar of cloud by day. And when they got there, they were like, what is this? What's going on? We're going to be destroyed. And what God tells these guys is, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Actually, Moses says it in the passage. Do not be afraid. And again, that's one of the things that God would speak to you. If God is leading you, and that's a big if, he needs to be the one leading you. And so you go through and you try to make sure that when you're making these choices in your life, that it's really the way that God wants you to go. And if God is leading you, and he's led you to a certain position, then you don't need to be afraid when circumstances look like they're going to go against you. And that's what their problem was. They get led up to the Red Sea, which was fine with them until Pharaoh's army comes along. Then all of a sudden, the circumstances change, and they start panicking about the whole thing. And so they call out to the Lord. They blame Moses. Moses goes and talks to God. And Moses comes back and says, don't be afraid. And then the second thing that he says is stand still. Stand still. If God has led you in a certain direction, then God is, and you've gotten yourself into a position where it looks like things are coming against you. If God has led you there, he's got you there for a reason. And probably one of the reasons he's got you there is because he wants to be the one to get you out of there. He doesn't lead you into little traps to see if you can get out on your own. He leads you into those areas so that he can show himself strong. And you see some of this in the New Testament. Remember Peter getting out of the boat? So Jesus says, Peter says, they see Jesus walking on the water. They start freaking out. And Jesus says, don't be afraid. It's me. Same thing. Don't be afraid. It's me. And Peter says, he gets gutsy, and he says, if it's you, Lord, tell me to come out. And Jesus goes, okay, come on out. And Peter gets out, and he starts walking on water. You know the story. He realizes, wait, this is physically impossible. I'm a human being. I cannot walk on water. And then there's wind and waves and stuff like that, and all the circumstances start getting in the way of what God had said to him, and then he begins to sink. And what happens then is Jesus says, you're an idiot and a bozo. Swim back to the boat. No, he doesn't. He reaches out, grabs Peter, picks him up, and they both walk back to the boat, walking on water. And he says to him, Peter, why did you doubt? Why did you doubt? And when you have a clear direction from the Lord, there's no reason to doubt. There's no reason to be afraid. So don't be afraid. Stand still. And see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. And then look in verse 14. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. God will fight for you. And again, that's one of those things that was new to me when I first became a Christian, because before I was a Christian, when people would do rotten things to me, nobody else was going to take care of me, so I had to take care of myself. And I spent a lot of time taking care of myself, taking care of people who did rotten things to me. I spent years getting back at people. I'm vengeful. I'll burn your house down. It's like, not really. I never burn anybody's house down. And I've told the stories before. When I was in high school, I'm a sophomore in high school, and I'm trying to be friendly with everybody and trying to be nice with everybody because I want people to like me and stuff like that. And certain people will take advantage of that, and what they did was they started doing rotten things to me. So I went out for football, wasn't that great at it. Guys on the football team started picking on me, hide my cleats, hide my helmet, just mess around with me all the time. And there were like four or five guys that did that, and I just started getting tired of it. And so what I did in my sophomore year was I decided I'm getting every single one of these guys. There's one guy that came up to me on the quad for just about every day, 2 weeks straight, trying to pick a fight with me, during school hours and stuff like that. And I just put it off and just tried not to get in the fight and that kind of stuff. And he ended up showing up at a basketball game. I had gone to another school a year before my freshman year, and my friends from that, so we were playing that team. And my friends from that school were at that basketball game, and so we're all standing out in front of the gym. And this dude about three of his guys come up, and he starts in again. And his name was Russell. I told him, Russell, you need to back it off, because I just want you to back it off. I can't remember exactly what I said. There were probably some cuss words thrown in there, because I was not following the Lord. And he didn't, and so I busted him in the mouth and knocked him out in front of his buddies. And that started Steve Winery in high school. And so it was Russell Solis and Art Aguilar, can't remember, Mark Brown, Jerry Ford, Tim Feathergill. I beat up every one of them. Beat the snot out of, actually, except for Jerry Ford. I shouldn't have said his last name, sorry. You don't know these people. He was the president of the United States. No. I don't know. He wouldn't fight. And so I didn't chase him down. But what I did was I went and got back every single one of those guys, and I did it publicly, and I made sure that I humiliated him. And so Art Aguilar went to the hospital. And the other guys, not so bad, that kind of stuff. But that's what I did. That's who I was. And when I became a Christian, I'm like, uh-oh, now what do? When people do rotten things to me, what do I do now? And Jesus says stupid things like turn the other cheek, that kind of stuff. And I'll fight for you. And, you know, those kinds of things. And vengeance, it's not yours, it's mine, you know, says the Lord, and that whole thing. And I knew that I wasn't supposed to be like I was in the world, but I didn't really know how that all that stuff was supposed to work out as a Christian. And so I kind of fumbled my way through it. I haven't been in a fight since I gave my life to Jesus. Haven't been in a fight since I gave my life to Jesus. And I'm talking about that, you know, after I backslid and I came back to the Lord. So I haven't been in a fight since I was 19 years old. And it's not like I haven't been in confrontations, but I've never been in a fight since that point. I'm not afraid to get in a fight. You know, it's like it was always natural to me. Actually, I got involved in martial arts, taekwondo, with the Takatas, and that was when I was in my 40s. You know why I didn't do it until I was in my 40s? Because I was afraid. And what I was afraid of was that whole attitude, all of that junk, would come right back into my life, and I'd be this guy who just wanted to pound guys, and I don't want to be there anymore. Actually, we got some guys in our fellowship that do Israeli fighting techniques. You know what Israeli fighting techniques are? Everything that I did when I was in high school. No mercy. Knock them down, pound them. That kind of stuff. And so I've never gotten involved with that because I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be like that anymore. And what I want to be is somebody who really trusts God to be the one who fights for me. And so it's not like I won't stand up for principle and things like that, because obviously, you know, you guys have been here long enough to know that kind of stuff. But when it gets personal, I just back it off and let the Lord take care of the whole thing. God will fight for me. I don't have to defend myself anymore. Jesus is the one who defends me. And that's what he's saying there. And it's the same thing with you. You don't have to make things happen. You don't have to fight your way through things. And God will make it happen. Stand still. God will fight. Hold your peace. You know, there's a passage in Isaiah chapter 30, verses 15 and 16. It says this: "For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest you shall be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. But you would not. And you said, no, for we will flee on horses. Therefore you shall flee, and we will ride on swift horses. Therefore those who pursue you shall be swift." And what he was talking about was the nation of Judah and the fact that they refused to trust in God. And they always went to plan A, which was never what the Lord wanted. It was what they wanted. And so if they were in a situation where they didn't think God was going to take care of them, what they just did was flee. And so God says, you're going to flee. And the ones who pursue you are going to be faster than you, because you wouldn't trust in me. And so we want to be in a position where we have a quietness and we have a peace and we have a rest in God, that God's going to take care of it. One other story. Before I married Bobby, actually before I started dating Bobby, I was going out with a girl. And it just wasn't working out. And I was trying to, you know, keep the relationship godly and that kind of thing. But she wanted to be married to me. And you know, it's like, I don't want to make myself like I'm this big catch or something. But this chick wanted to be married to me, and she could see that I was going to be a pastor. I didn't even know it at the time. But she was constantly talking about me being a pastor and her being a pastor's wife and all this kind of stuff. So she had this whole trip laid on me. And, you know, it got to this point where I was like, this is not what God wants. You know, I'm really having some problems with this whole issue. And I, you know, kind of tried to break it off, but she could see where I was going. And so she started talking about Thanksgiving and how much fun we were going to have. And then I got guilted into doing Thanksgiving. Then she started talking about Christmas and how great that was going to be. And I got guilted into that whole thing. And God had spoken to me and told me to break off the relationship in a kind way earlier than that. And I just didn't do it because I'm a wimp. And so, with girls at least, I'm a wimp. And so I just didn't do it. And so what ended up happening was when I broke it off, it became this really bad thing. And she got really mad at me. And she started going around and talking to all my friends about how rotten I was and this kind of stuff. And you have to understand from my point of view what was going on there. The only friends that I had were the friends that I had at church. Because I had left everybody. When I became a Christian, Jesus talks, the word talks about the fact that I'm not supposed to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And so I went around and talked to my unbelieving friends, but when it became obvious that they didn't want to have anything to do with Jesus and that they wanted to drag me back into the whole party world and everything that I was before, I had to start severing relationships. So now I've got nobody, and what I had was my buds at church. Well, guess who she went to? And what ended up happening was they believed her and went through and this awful thing happened to me where all the people that I loved the most ended up turning their backs on me. And they didn't do it in a radically mean way, but they did it. And it was devastating to me in the sense that, I wasn't sitting in my apartment crying or something, but it was devastating to me in the sense that, when I became a Christian, this is my family. And these are my friends, and I'm a guy that, it's like you're in that position, you're there for the rest of your life. I've got friends that I haven't talked to in, I can go 2 or 3 years without talking to guys, and as soon as I get back with them, boom, we just start up right where we left off, and we're tight. And we don't call each other every month and stuff, but it's like we're tight, and it's always been like that. With some of my friends who were Christians. Well, in any case, what ended up happening was there were some real problems there. And at the same time, what God did with me was he moved me up to Big Bear to help my father-in-law, my future father-in-law, build a house. And so I was up there for about 6 months, 7 months, something like that. And I had moved out of town. And so after that point, when my wife and I were deciding where we were going to live, I wanted to be where all the action was, which was a Harvest Christian Fellowship with Greg Laurie, and so moved back down there and stuff. And when I got back down, all of a sudden, everybody started coming up to me and apologizing. And, they were good about the whole thing in the sense that they didn't tell me everything that went on, but they just, all the guys that had basically turned their back on me came walking up to me and said, "Steve, really sorry I did that to you, should never have gone there, will you please forgive me," and that kind of stuff. And so got some friendships restored, and it was a real cool thing. And I don't know what happened to that chick. I have no idea what happened to her, but something happened, and everybody got their eyes opened, and they saw exactly what was going on. And she was gone, and again, everybody was apologetic. That period of time when I was up in Big Bear building that house, I was actually right at the beginning of that, and right previous to that, before I had moved up, I was praying really hard because I wanted to go find her and pound her face. And I'm not joking. I'm a young Christian at this point, and so this is like 1982. I got saved in 85. I rededicated my life to I got saved in 75. That wouldn't work. I got saved in 75. I rededicated my life to the Lord right around 1979, right in there. And so I'd only been walking strong with the Lord for a few years. And so my life was, you get in my face, I pound you. And now I'm in a situation where this chick literally was taken away, all these people that I loved and that were my family. I didn't have anybody else, and I was pretty mad about it. And so I remember sitting in my apartment, laying on my bed going, "God, you got to keep her away from me because if I see her, I'm going to do something bad. And I never, you know, I didn't see her. And then he moved me out. And then months later, I come back. And guess what God did? He fought for me. And what I did was I held my peace. And I just waited. And that's what I do to this day. Because God is totally able to take care of me. And God is totally able to take care of you. And so you got to trust him. The next thing that you see in verse 15, it says, and the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. And so we have, again, a progression here. There's circumstances that go against the people. They respond with fear. God's answer is don't be afraid. You look to God, not the circumstances. You need to stand still, and God's going to be the one who fights. You need to hold your peace. And then at the word of the Lord, it says that they went forward. And what God did for them was he opened up a door for them that they could pass through. And it was a miracle. The Red Sea parts. Let's go on and read it. He says, lift up your rod to Moses, verse 16, and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I indeed will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. So I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, his chariots and his horsemen. Then the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gained honor for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen. And the angel of God, who went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them. A pillar of cloud went from before them, stood behind them. We talked about this last week. God is our rear guard. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. Thus it was a cloud in darkness to the one, and it gave light by night to the other, so that the one did not come near the other all that night. And again, God will be the one who protects you. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night and made the sea into dry land. And the waters were divided. So the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on the dry ground. And the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. Now it came to pass in the morning watch that the Lord looked down upon the army of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and cloud, and he troubled the army of the Egyptians. He took off their chariot wheels so that they drove them with difficulty, and the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians. Really? You're in the middle of the Red Sea, walls of water on one side and on the other side, a pillar of fire in front of you, and your chariot wheels are falling off, and God's fighting for them. Duh. You know, what maniac goes into the Red Sea? It's hard for me to get past that whole thing. What maniac follows a pillar of fire through the Red Sea trying to get to the other side? Dumb. In any case, they get there and they get everything that they deserve at that point. So, you know, when you're looking at what God does with you, what he'll do is he'll open a door for you so that you can get through it. And as you're going through it, you can expect that God's going to protect you the whole way through. You know, there are these spiritual battles that take place in our lives where we don't know what's going on. And obviously in this case, they can see the events, they can see what's happening. But with us, we don't know what God's doing. And a lot of times our complaint is, God, are you doing anything? Is anything going on? And we need to understand that God is constantly at work behind the scenes, blessing and protecting and watching out for us. You know the story in the book of Kings where Elisha, I should have looked it up. It's Elisha, king of Syria, has sent to get this guy because he keeps telling the king of Israel the plans, the battle plans of the king of Syria. And so basically they're having this fight between Israel and Syria. Elisha comes up to the king and would tell him what the Syrians are going to do. And so this is how you need to array your forces and that kind of stuff. Well, king of Syria hears about this, and so he decides to go and surround this guy. And so he catches him in a city, And he sends his chariots out to surround him. And so the whole city's surrounded. And his servant goes out and he's looking out on these chariots. And he's like, what are we going to do? We're surrounded. And what the prophet says is, open his eyes, Lord. And he opens his eyes. And what the prophet also says to him is, those who are for us are more than those who are against us. And when his eyes get opened in the spiritual realm, what he sees is this whole group of angels on chariots, and the chariots are on fire, chariots of fire. You know the movie? That's where it came from, it came out of the Bible. So these chariots are on fire, they're all around him, and this guy had no clue that this was taking place. So the prophet, who's sitting in his house, is all calm and peaceful because he knows that God's going to take care of him. And the other guys, who are just living in the natural realm, are all flipped out. And again, it's the same thing with us. God watches out for you. God will take care of you. God will be doing things in the spiritual realm, and he'll watch out for you. Then finally, there's the miracle of the parting of the Red Sea. And so the waters part, and they go through the Red Sea. Let's just read the rest of it. It says, and the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand, verse 26, over the sea, that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians on their chariots and on their horsemen. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. And when the morning appeared, the sea returned to its full depth while the Egyptians were fleeing into it. So the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. And then the waters returned and covered the chariots, the horsemen, and all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. Not so much as one of them remained, but the children of Israel had walked on dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. And again, what God does in that situation is he does this miracle in parting the Red Sea, so these guys can be delivered, and so that you can end up with verse 31. Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt, so the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. And that's where God wants to get you, where you'll fear the Lord and you'll believe him, no matter what's going on. But again, you need to be led by God. And the Bible is clear on the fact that that's something that God wants to do with you. He wants to lead you. Chapter 15 is a song of praise that the people of Israel begin. This is actually the song of Moses that the people of Israel sing after God has delivered them from the Egyptians in the Red Sea. And that's what happens when you are trusting in God and God does these acts of deliverance in your life. At the end of it, what you do is you praise him and you honor him and you bless him. And again, when you're looking at what a Christian life is supposed to be, it's supposed to be one that's led by the Lord. The mature sons of God, the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, are led by the Spirit. And it's sons in the generic. And so the mature people of God are led by the Spirit. And that's what we're supposed to be doing. So I need to stop doing things on my own. And I need to start seeking the Lord. And when I am in a trial, I need to be calling upon him, and he'll deliver me. Let's just end it with that. Turn over to Psalm 50. Psalm 50. That's what we started with last week. That's what we'll end with this week. Starting in verse 7. Hear, O my people, and I will speak, O Israel, and I will testify against you. I am God, your God. Verse 8. I will not rebuke you for your sacrifices or your burnt offerings, which are continually before me. I will not take a bull from your house nor goats out of your folds, for every beast of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know all the birds of the mountains and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine and all its fullness. So I don't support God. God supports me. Verse 13, will I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer to God thanksgiving. And that's what God wants from us. He wants a thankful heart. Pay your vows to the Most High. You know, there is a contract that I made with Jesus when I first got saved, and I need to pay it. Pay my vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble. And it's a command. When I'm in trouble, I'm to call upon him, and I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. And that's what your life is supposed to be. That's what it's supposed to look like. I want to be somebody who glorifies the Lord, and I want to do it because he's really there, and I want to do it because he's really delivered me. So I'm no different than you are. You're no different than I am. I am different than David. I'm in a better position. But I'm no different in the sense that I've got the relationship with the same God who was alive back then. He's still alive now. Our God does not change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he'll do these things in your life if you'll trust him. So let's all stand. Let me pray for you. God, thank you again for the promise in your word, Lord, that if we seek after you with all our heart, that we'll be found by you. And God, you have promise after promise in scripture about the fact that you're a God who's at work in us, and you're a God who's at work for us, and you're a God who wants to bless us. And Lord, we just pray that you'd give us a heart that would listen and follow after you. We want to be people who actually trust in you. And we want to be people who trust in you and not in other people and not in bank accounts and not in our own wisdom, but in you and you alone. God, I thank you for these people and thank you for hearts that want to hear your word and want to follow you. And God, as they do that, I just pray that you bless them and that you'd specifically speak to them and show them the way that they should be going. And again, Lord, we just pray for the power of your Holy Spirit on our lives and just pray that you would help us to be good witnesses of you in the world. And we ask this in Jesus' name.